Financial management, chapter one. This is lecture number two. I covered a lot of from last time. What is the management's goal? Key theories about it, the common methods, provide a model for evaluating an MNC. Let's see quickly. So, managers are expected to make decisions that will maximize the stock price. So, the goal in financial management, whether it's a domestic company or international company, is maximizing the stock price. I covered this last time. Okay, focus of this text will be multinational corporations, okay, whose parents fully own the subsidiaries. So, what are common business disciplines are used to manage an MNC? So, you have finance decisions, okay? To continue operations or to discontinue operations? To pursue new business or not to pursue new business in a particular country? Say you're an Emirati business, open business in Saudi or don't open, okay? Or if you already have a business, keep going or close. To expand business, you already have a business there, you want to expand or you don't want to expand. Next one is how to finance expansion. In other words, the first one is a capital budgeting type decision. The second one, the last one is a financing decision. Okay, so when you make decisions in finance, you're influenced by marketing. Is there going to be a market? Are you going to be able to sell? Are you going to be able to grow? Will they buy your product? Will they not buy your product? Okay. You may try to sell some special perfume in Russia, and Russian people don't like it, maybe. Okay. You need marketing feedback. Management. You need to have management. You need to have management resources. And of course, accounting and finance. And information system. Everything in finance is based on accounting. You need to know accounting. Now this is like too much going in and out. Let's try again a little bit and see if it's gonna work a little better or not. All right, so whenever you have a multinational corporation, whenever you have any kind of corporation or any business which is not run by the owner, but instead it's run by a manager, parent, agency problem. It's called a principal agent problem, where the manager runs it for his own interest. And there are costs associated with having a manager, because you have to monitor him, you have to watch him, you gotta put in a lot of extra time, effort, and costs. And there will be still some losses. He won't be working 8 hours or 12 hours a day. Okay, so cost number one is associated with monitoring managers. Okay. The bigger the corporation, the bigger the agency cost. It's difficult to keep track of what these people are doing, to oversee, monitor, to control them, okay? So, usually multinational corporations will have a bigger agency costs. All right, well, there are certain parent control of agency problems. So, parent continually communicate the goals and whatnot. And you have corporate control. Entire management must be focused on maximizing share. This is just the standard stuff. We're not going to discuss SOX, Sarbanes-Oxley Act is specific only to fraud in the United States. Doesn't concern most people outside the world. It's not important outside. So, how SOX improved corporate governance? Well, maybe improved it, maybe not. We don't want to concern. In other words, agency costs and agency problems are part of corporate governance. governance. And corporate governance is how managers and in general the corporation is run, who makes decisions, who controls what and how, who hires, who fires, who selects the CEO, who selects the board of directors, and all of those problems associated with it. So what's a typical management structure? I already covered last time. You can have a centralized and a decentralized structure, okay? And centralized decisions are made at headquarters, decentralized are made in the foreign branches. Okay, internet greatly helps, facilitates management control. Now it's very easy in the office, let's say in Germany, to call the office somewhere far away and talk constantly and have communication. People don't have to fly once a month or every couple of months. Now they can talk whenever is needed to take care of business. Alright, so this is a centralized multinational financial management. You have a financial manager of parent. They're going to keep track of cash at subsidiary A and keep cash track of cash management at subsidiary B. There's going to be inventory accounts for A, inventory accounts for B. They're going to keep track of financing and capital expenditures. So everything in financial management rolls around capital expenditures and investments on the one side, the asset side, and financing on the other side. So you're simply going to keep track of everything, and everything is centralized. Very simple. And this will be a picture of decentralized. You have financial manager subsidiary A, they take their own stuff. Then have financial manager of the subsidiary B, and they take care of their own stuff, and each makes their own decisions independently. Now, why businesses will go and do an international business? Why are you going to go to a foreign country? Number one, competitive advantage. Somehow you may be more competitive than another country. For example, China is a cheap labor. So China, Chinese labor is cheap and makes labor-intensive goods India supposedly has more technology, more computer and IT people. So you go in India for software, for programming, and all sorts of other things. There's also an imperfect market theory, which simply says that the factors of production cannot move freely. So there's an incentive to seek foreign opportunities. So workers cannot move all workers from Philippines to some other country. They're stuck over there. Computer scientists are stuck in India, okay? They can't just get out. So if factories cannot move, there is advantage in possibly trading or in putting your business there. This is what a lot of major international, let's say, software computer giants in the US, they open a subsidiary in India and you make use of abundant, cheap computer and IT guys in India. And there's a product cycle theory basically says, hey, I'm inventing the product, I'm the first in the world to make it, I'm very competitive in my market, and I can expand and be the first with already good production service and everything else in a second country, and I don't have a competition there.
Good evening.
So, what is the life cycle? Well, life cycle you need to understand from elementary marketing. You should learn, you should know, you should understand what is the product life cycle. Again, here for the next quiz, I'll be expecting your specific knowledge. Which are the stages of the international product life cycle? And stage one, for it creates product to
which are the one?
chapter 1.
Third,
creates product to accommodate local demand.
Number 2, stage number 2.
Third, exports product to accommodate foreign demand. Step number 3, establishes foreign subsidiary.
So, number 1, you make it at home. Number 2, export it abroad. Number 3, you make a subsidiary there. And let's see, what's 4A and 4B? And then you can differentiate the product and in the foreign country, or you can make your product match the foreign country better.
Okay, here's an example. Germany, BMW produces cars. Well, they produce the X3, which is the small SUV in Germany,
but the big
X5 is produced for the American market in Mexico.
Alright,
so they make a slightly customized product because Americans prefer bigger car to smaller cars. And they make a subsidiary there, they make a manufacturing there. So now they exploit two things. They exploit NAFTA, which is free trade between the United States and Mexico. They exploit the big market in the United States. They exploit the demand for a bigger vehicle where there's no such demand in Europe. Okay, people don't buy big cars usually in Europe. And they exploit at the same time the cheap Mexican labor. All right, so that's an extraordinary example of an international MNC benefiting from trade and from production, from the lower cost, from the customer, from being close to the customer and cutting down on shipping, transportation, and tariffs. If you're in NAFTA, there are no special taxes, there are no tariffs. If you make it in Germany and export it to the United States, there is a special tax, an import tariff. Let's see what's next. Okay, how firms engage in international business.
Alright,
that will be another very specific question where I expect specific answers. So, the first way is international trade. Number 2, licensing. Number 3, franchising, joint ventures. You can acquire existing foreign company, or you can establish and build it and grow it from the beginning. So there are 2, 4, 6. So a simple basic question for the quiz is explain 5 or explain 3 or explain 4 major methods to engage in international business. Okay, let's see one by one if you have. Yes.
Number 1.
International trade. It's very conservative, it's very easy, you risk very little, you're not subject a lot to foreign stuff, you put your goods there, if you sell them, you bring more. Okay? It's that simple. So you start small and you slowly grow the trade. Okay? It is used to penetrate, means to enter the market for the first time and try to expand in that market if you can. And obtain supplies at low cost. Okay, there's minimal risk, there's no capital risk, okay? And the internet facilitates it because now it's very easy. You have your own product here, all customers from around the world, they make an order on your website, and you just ship it to China, Japan, whoever demands your product, okay? So, international trade is number 1.
Number 2.
Licensing. It obligates a firm to provide its technology. So you license your technology. What is the copyright or the patent, the trademark, the trade name in exchange for fees? It's very similar to franchising, but here all you do is you give your technology and your name. Next will be franchise, and I'll discuss a little
They can use their technology in foreign markets. So you just give them your technology and they'll use the technology in the foreign. But you don't make an investment there. But it's difficult to ensure quality. In other words, if you give your technology to someone in China, is he going to use it properly or not properly? Is he going to manufacture a quality product or not a quality product? Okay, it's almost kind of like, think of it, you got a particular medicine and you give them a license technology to manufacture the medicine. Maybe the medicine is going to be good, but maybe not good. Question?
Between licensing and franchising.
All right, well, let's discuss what is franchising first. We need to know the exact definition, right? And then it can make the difference. So, franchising obligates the firm to provide specialized sales or service strategy, particular support system, possibly initial investment, okay, alliance penetration. So within the franchise, you tell them you're going to have that kind of cashier, you're going to have these particular products, these particular
layout. You are giving the layout.
Yeah, you're giving the layout, you're giving the service strategy, like you must serve customer within 3 minutes on the line. When the customer orders, they must get their food within 1.5 minutes. So there are strict requirements to the point where McDonald's here, the same as in Bulgaria,
is mainly franchising in the food sector.
Well, it could be in the hotel sector. So when you go in Ritz Carlton Hotel in Bulgaria, it's exactly the same as Ritz-Carlton in London and in New York and in Dubai. So, could be not only food, could be hotels, could be possibly other types of businesses. In other words, you know what to expect. You have some quality assurance, okay? You have some service assurance, okay? So KFC there is here is the same as KFC in Bulgaria, the same as in America. And similarly, Subway. Subway I ate a long time ago when I was in the United States 20 years ago, when I was a student, 97, 98, and I traveled to Florida from Ohio, I ate in Subway. Well, 15 years later, when I eat in Subway in Bulgaria, it's pretty much the same. When I ate here Subway, it's pretty much the same. The same menu, and well, prices will be slightly different here. Okay, but it's all the same thing. Question?
It's okay.
It's okay. All right. So,
but I want one example. Now you give hotels and food sector.
Right.
One example for licensing.
For example, you have a particular technology, how to make a bottle, okay? And you give them the technology.
If you have.
Well, I don't have, but I'll come up later with examples on licensing, on how you license. I'll come up later. All right, let's move on. Joint venture is company A and company B, they join together and form a new company C. And C will be shared, maybe equally, maybe not, by A and B. And the new joint venture will have a specific purpose, specific goal. Develop brand new diesel engine, develop brand new phone, develop brand new camera. Now it could be from two different companies, French company, British company, joint venture, let's say in Myanmar, to drill for oil, okay? Searching for oil, okay?
India.
Okay. Well, maybe they just have a foreign operation here. Maybe it's just an export.
IKEA, IKEA company.
Right, it may be a simple export.
Export, yeah.
Yes, maybe. Probably. You need to know where it's manufactured. Maybe it's not manufactured in the home country. Maybe it was manufactured in China and shipped from China. Maybe they have a foreign operation in China. Maybe it's manufactured in China and then shipped here. Just like Apple. Apple, when you open your, well, when I turn the back of my MacBook computer, it says designed in California, made in China. So they'll have an operation. Maybe they license the Chinese company to manufacture the Apple MacBooks up to their standards, okay? Maybe they'll have a quality assurance. They have to make sure that the quality is perfect, perfect, okay? And then it's shipped over here for sale or in Thailand or in any other country in the world. All right, so that's the joint venture, okay? So, in a joint venture, there are two things. You're expert in this and you're expert in that. So we share expertise. In joint ventures, well, there's too much risk and we'll need maybe $1 billion investment to drill for oil. So you're gonna supply $500 million and you will supply $500 million. Or maybe you supply quarter billion, and we're gonna get a loan from the bank.
Do you have an example?
Well, I just gave
you banks, they are making, they cancel two banks and they join make.
That's a completely different story. This is a merger or acquisition.
Merger.
Right now, again, I'm just talking about venture. Have two companies and they decide we're gonna go in Myanmar and we're gonna drill for oil, hoping to get some. Okay, that's it.
Because we are here in joint venture, but at my work, but I think they are using it the wrong way.
Well, again, that's the point. You are coming here to class so that you don't think or have opinion. You know, this is what the joint venture is. In Bulgaria, Russia, Japan, Saudi Arabia, America, this is joint venture. That's it, you need to know. And next time I'll be asking you on the quiz, okay? Next one is what you are asking for. Acquisition of existing operations. You have a company here in your country and have a company in some other country, India, China, Saudi, Bahrain, and you buy the company. And now it's one company. That's an acquisition, okay? Or the two companies get together and becomes one company. If they get together as a group, it's called a merger. Okay. So when two companies come into one, it's either acquisition or a merger. If it's equal, it's called merger. If one buys the other, acquisition. That's it. Again, that's what I'm saying is you must understand the strict definition, and then it's not a matter of what you think, what they think. You know what is what, okay? Example of a definition. This is my left hand. The whole world in Japan, China, Russia, Bulgaria, Greece, this is my left hand. That's it, left hand. It's not important what you think. Last time we discussed, the left hand in the accounting tree is called debit. Period. This is what the whole world has agreed for 500 years since accounting was invented in Italy. Not accounting, the double entry accounting was invented in Italy. Again, you need to know the definition. I expect specific knowledge with specific definitions. Okay? Understand? Question?
Yeah.
Go on.
Germany.
Yes.
Two countries then became one. We can't say merger.
Again?
Germany in the past. Two countries. Then became one.
Yes, it's a merger between
merger.
Yes. Correct. Next. You could establish a brand new subsidiary. You go in there, you get the legal name, you do everything, and you begin the operation as a brand new subsidiary. Okay, and that's like what Pepsi did when it opened a brand new subsidiary here in the UAE. That was many years ago.
Pepsi giving license.
Yes, or they can give license, or the company itself will open the operation here. Okay, just recently they opened it about 2 years ago in Dubai, a brand new facility. Okay, and from here they're exporting possibly even to Oman.
Oman?
Oman, right. So instead of having an operation there, they have the operation here, they manufacture here, and then just export it, just ship it over there, just with a truck.
Okay,
simple example. Now, the big problem with a foreign subsidiary requires a large investment. It could be risky, okay? Like you put in a large investment in Lebanon, and then there is a civil war. And after the civil war, there's a war with Israel, right? So it's just an example of risky business, okay? Or you open a business in Iraq, and then the American bombarded in 2003-04, and then from your investment, there's no government, no law, no judge, no court, no nothing. Okay. So, large investment and a lot riskier. Okay. So, as the capital that is required increases, with the capital increases the risk. So, usually risk is proportional to the capital, the initial investment. And then I have a short summary. Okay. And then that is what? Okay. That's important. Direct foreign investment. Sometimes it's called the opposite, FDI, foreign direct investment. Both of these are correct and both mean exactly the same thing. And again, we try again the definition. What is it? Again, increasing international requires a direct investment in foreign operation. So a direct investment means you have control of it, and you have a significant ownership, maybe 30, maybe 40, maybe 70, maybe 90%. You have ownership large enough to control it. If you control it, it's an FDI. Okay. International trade and licensing is not considered an FDI. Okay, because again, you're not really making your ownership there. In the licensing, you give them the license. Today, own the company. Right?
Like franchising. Licensing and franchising. A way of.
Right. Now, this is what tells you what is the biggest portion of FDI. FDI happens usually either by a new subsidiary or a foreign acquisition. So 80-90% of all FDI in the world is simply foreign acquisition. You just buy the foreign company or you establish a brand new business. In other words, the licensing and the franchising is a small thing. It's not very important. It's a small in proportion to the FDI, just a small percentage of the FDI. Let's see what else we got. And they got summary of methods, okay, first diagram, they got all of these, let's see, they have some explanations of diagrams, okay, so international trade, cash flow goes this way, okay, exporting, cash flows to pay for importing, okay, using licensing, franchising, and joint venture, these are just the cash flows, there's nothing really interesting to know. Okay, here is the MNC, and I got importers and exporters. Here there's a foreign firm or government agency, and here you got foreign subsidiaries. Okay, so here you just send them the goods, they pay you the money. Okay, here you own the companies. It's a foreign subsidiary. Subsidiary means that you own it. We call it parent.
Or you have control of
it. Subsidiary.
Yes, if you own it, control it.
Yeah. Two subsidiaries.
Okay, well, they'll decide.
Subsidiary. Let's talk about the translation of the subsidiary.
Again?
Well, let's talk about the meaning of
subsidiary.
Subsidiary means there is a, I explained it last time, you should look at your notes, there's a parent company, a mother company, and there's subsidiary. Subsidiary is called the daughter company.
I think there is an example of it of two company cars. I guess it was
some company.
I think it was Porsche and Range Rover or something like that.
Yeah, look, there could be 1,000 examples. Okay. Sorry, company or subsidiary. I give an example of a subsidiary of Pepsi company here making an investment, direct foreign investment. And you have valuation. Well, what is valuation? It's cash flow.
Mother company, we can't say mother company.
Yes, mother company, but usually we call parent company. The other one is called daughter company. We never call it son. Daughter company or subsidiary. Next one is valuation. Valuation for an international corporation is exactly the same as a valuation for a domestic corporation. It is based on the discounted cash flow formula, which is simply you take the cash flow, you take the expected value of the cash flow, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 years from now, and then you discounted at the weighted average cost of capital.
Okay,
weighted average cost of capital. So that's how you weight it, okay? So the cash flow 3 years from now, you cannot be sure what it is. So instead of that, you take the expected. Maybe we'll make 4, maybe we'll make 5 million. Well, let's put the average 4.5. The expected value. Alright. So, if you have a domestic model, again, I just explained these are the dollar cash flows. This is the top part, the cash flow in dollar terms. And the other one is cost of capital, which, as you said, is the weighted average cost of capital. We just call it cost of capital, okay? So this is the required rate of return. It is, here is written for you, a weighted average of cost of capital, okay? Now, it could be cost of capital based on all firms' project or based on all of the firms' financing. Cost of capital in short-term debt, cost of capital of long-term debt, yeah, cost of capital of preferred stock, cost of capital of common stock. Okay. Now, what's the average between debt and equity? And the multinational model is very similar, except that you get the expected cash flow by doing the exchange rate. So SJT represents the exchange rate. So you got the same cash expected cash flows, but you add an extra piece of the expected exchange rate because you can't really know for sure. Now, maybe as we'll study in a couple of weeks, you can hedge it. You can get a futures contract, you can get a forward contract, or you can make the exchange now just to be sure. In other words, there are ways to hedge the exchange rate risk. So, the valuation uses two currencies. As they will explain later, you start with two currencies, you can extend it to 3, 4 to 10 to unlimited number of currencies, and you always use what's called the base currency, sometimes called the
domestic currency, the other one is called the foreign currency. And the valuation is done in a particular currency, usually the domestic currency, and you convert all cash flows, Japanese cash flows, you convert with the Japanese yen to domestic, Chinese cash flows to the Chinese exchange rate to the domestic, okay? Indian cash flow through the Indian rupee exchange rate to the domestic, and so on. Thai cash flow through the Thai baht exchange rate back to the home. And that's how you do it. And it's exactly the same thing. Cost of capital will be similar for the whole multinational corporation. All right, so the MNC, now you see all of this stuff. This is it, and this okay, discount estimate cash flow for each period, but the weight again, the weighted average cost of capital. It's exactly the same concept. But the weighted average cost of capital could be for a multinational on the one hand, a little higher because projects in a foreign country could be riskier, but on the other, weighted average cost of capital could be lower because the multinational could have cheap borrowing from abroad. For example, now or for a while, borrowing was cheap from Japan. Japan has extremely low interest rates. It's very cheap to borrow. So if you're a multinational, you could benefit by borrowing from Japan as an example. Okay. Let's see what else we got. As I just mentioned, cash flows of a multinational corporation could have a little bit more uncertainty. It's not just your own economy now, but you're affected by what happens in Japan and in China and in Russia and in Brazil and of course the United States. And in other words, in the rest of the world. Okay. So, next. There is additional political risk, okay? Like British or Americans invested or bought or had oil company in Iran, and then the Iranian government had a political revolution, the Iranian revolution, and they took the American oil company and privatized it, okay? Next. The Americans invested in Saudi Aramco, okay? This is Aramco. What does it mean, Aramco?
Aramco.
Is the Saudi oil company.
Yeah.
Means Saudi American company. A-R means Aramco. America, right. Yeah. All right, so it was an American company. It was American owned. And later on, Saudi government just took it. Okay. So these things happen, okay? Or get oil in Kuwait, right? And then Saddam Hussein goes and makes a war on Kuwait, tries to take the oil, okay? Well, it's a different story. The Americans came. But the point is, there is international political risk, okay? And there is additional exchange rate risk. So, there is an economic risk, political risk, exchange rate risk. Now, take a note, a simple question. What are the three main risks surrounding MNC, multinational corporation? The three additional risks that multinational corporations
face. Three main risks in what?
Three main risks for a multinational corporation. The risk is you invest in another country and the country, the government, takes it from you.
So this is acquisition. Acquisition.
No. The government takes it, confiscates it, steals it from you. It takes it and gives you nothing in return. It just That happens all the time. When a government or a country gets in trouble in a difficulty, the first thing they want to do is what foreigners own and just export for it. Okay? So, these are the three main risks. Next, let's see what we have.
All right, 40 minutes.